Good evening and welcome to the Town of Tustin Public Hearing. Hearing number one will be for local law number two of 2021, a local law adopted pursuant to cannabis law section 131, opting out of licensing and establishing onsite cannabis consumption establishments within the Town of Tustin. Each person that wants to be heard will have that opportunity. We ask that the comments are made to the board. There is a microphone on this side. You can use the table faced towards the town clerk. We'll take comments from the floor first, and then we'll take comments from the Zoom audience. So whoever would like to start? Ned?
So in our little community, a community that's been wrought with all kind of drug problems for years and years and years. We've seen community members die. We know that cannabis, when allowed to be or not allowed to be, placed in the hands of those younger folks in our homes, is a problem. It is a gateway drug. There's no two ways about it. We don't need that kind of problem in this town. The town has enough problem with drugs. I own apartment houses. Drugs are a constant problem in this town. Why would we ever want to have more drugs and a dispensary in our town, bringing all walks of life into our little community? Maybe having drug deals across the bridge as young folks can come in and buy drugs on the Pennsylvania side, because you know that you're going to get all those people in here. Why would we allow that? And not only that, we have cities. We have Newburgh. We have Liberty. We have Middletown. Let that type of activity go on there. Not in our community. My mother started the recovery center along with the Ruins back in 1986. The recovery center in Monticello saved thousands of lives. I also would go there, and I talked to folks there. And she also started Better Way in Miami. And if you talk to a lot of those folks, how did you start with drugs? Well, back in those days, it wasn't opioids. It was, I used to mess around with the marijuana, stand on a street corner, and now another drug comes along. And so it was a better high, a nicer high, a longer high. We don't need that type of proliferation of drugs in our community. Not today, not tomorrow, not ever. We are a small town, wonderful community, and we have enough business coming into this community that we don't need that type of proliferation of drugs and those type of folks that will take advantage of folks that and sell it to younger folks throughout our community and other communities adjacent to us. So please vote no, and we will, if there's a referendum coming up, we will work hard to shut that referendum down and keep our community whole, our families whole, and our children safe.
Thank you. Randy?
Okay, so I'm just going to talk off the cuff today without a script, and
Randy, if you could just speak a little louder, the microphone's over here.
Okay, so I don't see it that way. New York State made this legal. It's not like, it is adult use, it's not children's use. And I just wanted to tell you that the story, I just looked up my emails yesterday to my father, 2017, and he had Parkinson's, had it for 10 years, and I had read an article, I sent it to him in an email, about how it could help him with his issues. Couldn't feed himself for 10 years, so this fork, he could not get it to his mouth. And so I sent him this article, and it showed incredible abilities that are restored with people who could not feed themselves or walk properly because he had Parkinson's. And he was the most anti-marijuana guy you'd ever meet in your life. And he said, you know what? I'm going to look into it. He looked into it. His doctor said, I highly recommend it for you. You're a good candidate for this. He gave him the tincture, and he called me like a week later when he did it the first time, and he said, I just fed myself for the first time in 5 years. Okay? So his gait was also improved. It wasn't sticking on the ground. When Parkinson's patients can walk, it's very hard to lift here. He started walking like a normal person. And it restored his dignity, and it helped him. To demonize a drug like this, there's recreational uses. You guys all drink, have bars, etc. And I don't see the difference. And New York State has just made it. the same. It's the same now. I'm not looking for people to take opioids for their pain. I'd rather have them use cannabis as a plant. And I feel really strongly about it because I watched my father learn how to walk again. And until he died, he used cannabis and it helped him. And you don't have to listen to what I have to say right now. I don't know if you guys looked at the Saugerties police chief video I sent you guys on the... You're laughing. I don't think that's funny, but, you know, I don't understand the resistance to learning about this, but that's okay because there will be a public referendum, and I have petitions after this meeting if you guys were to opt out, which is what I expect to happen. So thanks for trying. Two women on the board did attend the Cannabis Consortium, learned all about it, and did their own homework, and I applaud that. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Brandy.
Yep. Laura Gettle from Wilda. Again, am I ready to give you the statistics, facts about cannabis as an educator on law and law enforcement? However, I changed my mind about that. I will, however, share this one known fact in law enforcement. The opinion of one who holds a title is not always the popular opinion amongst all. Neither Ulster nor Orange County Police Chiefs Association has come out in favor of the legalization of cannabis, nor have they said they were not okay with it. They have no political view or standing on it. One police chief who I know to be held in little to no regard with the Ulster and Orange County Police Chiefs Association does not make for expert testimony. That I can speak to as fact, since I am well-traveled in the law enforcement community. What I am here to say today is I have, and my husband has, attended Narcotics Anonymous meetings. But we have a daughter. For 17 years, our daughter has battled addiction, and it will be a battle she will fight for the rest of her life. My husband and I, along with 1 million other grandparents, are raising our grandchildren today, largely due to drug addiction. That is a statistical fact. The stories these addicts tell are heart-wrenching, and their stories all start out the same way. It starts with the most abused drug in the United States today. That would be cannabis. You know the old adage, it's just weed until it's not just weed. I don't care if you want to grow it and smoke it. Just don't destroy our community and our lives and the lives of our children being raised here with it. Our country is in a drug epidemic, and our county has the highest drug overdoses in the state. Yes, even more than New York City. So put your dispensaries in a county that is facing insurmountable addiction and overdose problems, and let's set one smack dab at the town of Tustin. To me, that is just unconscionable, disgusting, and wrought with greed. For the love of God, where is our humanity?
Thank you. All right.
Sorry that I'm late. I did not realize that it was going to start before 6:15. So what I want to say is, this is in response to what you said, that people do not want people who use cannabis in the community. So I wanted to say that 2.5 years ago, I was supposed to go in for major surgery, total reverse shoulder replacement. I was in pain on a scale of 1 to 10, higher than a 9. And at that particular time, the surgeon contacted me, went into the office, and he said, there is this thing going around, COVID, and because of the fact that you have high susceptibility because of some of your issues, I think we should postpone it if you can possibly hold off. I knew that I was going to be facing at least 2 years of rehab, and there was no guarantee with this type of surgery that it would create or solve the problems that I was having and the pain that I had. In any case, I spoke to my neurologist, and the neurologist who knew that I would not take any kind of opiates said, would you take cannabis? And I said I would certainly try. And I went from a 9+ pain factor to below a 3, which is tolerable, and I live with that. I have not had to go for the surgery because the pain level has decreased. I am one of those people who live in this community who take a tincture twice a day under my tongue so that I can function, so that I can be an important member of this community. I have done a lot in this community. I will try to do even more. But I, like so many others, are those people that you say you don't want here. Thank you.
Star?
Having attended the cannabis program back in October, it really disturbs me greatly to hear the same false allegations being repeated over and over again that marijuana is a gateway drug. I don't think that Iris graduated to heroin after her pain went down. There are children that have seizures. I work in child protective services. We had a mother in foster care. Her 3-year-old daughter from a drug addicted parent had severe seizures. She would cry, "Mommy, mommy, mommy, I'm hurt, I'm hurt." The mother was frantic. They gave her marijuana. The seizures went down to maybe from multiple a day to maybe once a week and even less as it progressed on. I also experienced in child protective services calls out for family violence and abuse. Not one of the cases I went out on was somebody beating on another spouse or their children because they were high on marijuana. Drunk, yes, but marijuana, no. I don't understand the resistance to this. The constant statements when we have medical professionals say that this is not an addictive gateway. We've had the police in, albeit one person, but that person was also the chair of the New York State Police Association. And he also said, we're not jumping up and down with joy, but we also see that there are many other addictive substances that are perfectly legal that are causing more problems in the community than marijuana. There's no reason that this shouldn't be available. Nobody's urging anybody to go out and drive under the influence of any drug. But marijuana is something that very much helps people. It does not cause addiction or graduation into higher addiction. And I think that being so close-minded about it, anybody in this room that thinks that there isn't already an abundance of other drugs and marijuana available in the community is sadly deluding themselves. So I really think if you make it legal, people can come in, it can be regulated, you can keep an eye on what kind of quality is being put out, on how much people are using, and I think that this is something that would be a very beneficial thing for our county and our town.
Thank you, Star.
You're welcome.
I think we're talking about a few different uses. In other words, medical marijuana, I personally have no problem, but let it go through a doctor, let it go through a pharmacy, and let it be for that use. What we're talking about here is recreational, not somebody that needs it for pain and so forth like that. If they need it for pain or that, let them go to the doctor, they can get their prescription, let it go through a pharmacy and so forth like that. Let's face it, some of us went to college. I can't think of one of my friends that ended up in drug addiction that didn't start with marijuana. And you say it's not a leading thing, they all started with marijuana. Then they went into coke, and then they went into other things. It is, you know, no matter what you want to say, it really shouldn't be in this town. And I'll tell you, I remember back in the days when drinking was 21 in Pennsylvania and 18 in New York. The lines going across that bridge for drunk people and so forth. This is going to happen with legalized marijuana in New York. And they're going to be lined up at the bridge to come across, buy, go back, give it to their whoever they want, and we'll have no say over it. And do we really want that? Do we want to be noted as a town that sells pot? And, you know, I understand these people with medical marijuana, and I feel sorry for them, and I think it is a good use. I mean, I have some good friends that are on it now. I mean, and it does work for the pain. But it shouldn't be you that's deciding what pain medication you should take.
Thank you, Rick.
Okay, as of right now, 70% of the states, 36 of them in D.C., have legalized cannabis in some form. Recent polls suggest that 69% of Americans believe cannabis should be legalized and 91% believe it should be legalized for medical purposes. As a nation, we may be divided on a lot, but we seem to be coming to common middle ground on cannabis. As a community, we need to come together and let go of this past rhetoric that has been ingrained in us all, generation from generation, creating such a stigma. It has to be put behind us, and collectively we must move forward into a new era of safe, legal cannabis, just like we did alcohol years ago. Instead of talking more on cannabis, I would like to focus specifically on our town, and what I would like you all to consider before making your decision tonight. How can we opt out of a possible 3% tax revenue from a potentially multi-million dollar industry when we are facing a $7.5 million water system issue? And that was a quote from 10 years ago, if I recall. Is the board really comfortable going out of its way tonight to ban this industry that may potentially be able to come and inject revenue simply over feelings and opinions? I don't recall anyone suggesting a dispensary on Main Street, but I would say to that, Main Street is not suitable for a dispensary, given the parking situation that we have, which is the other major issue that we're going to have to fiscally address at some point. That's why I would suggest we leave this to the planning board to determine cannabis' viability in this town, instead of opting out tonight. I know traffic from PA is a concern, but that will likely happen no matter what, because we are the gateway, we are the regional bridge between Pennsylvania and New York. And it's my understanding Bethel does not plan on opting out. So we're going to see that traffic no matter what, and we're going to have the ramifications of that traffic no matter what, and we're going to watch the 3% revenue drive right by and deposit into another town's bank account. I also ask you to examine how we say no to cannabis while we are watching an 82-person rooftop bar deck with limited parking on a very highly trafficked street pending its opening in this town. How is everybody comfortable with that? Alcohol was a formerly prohibited drug that wreaks havoc still on our society today. And in more recent studies, it's actually considered the gateway drug, since young people tend to try alcohol and nicotine first, not marijuana. And it is different from the rest of the drugs. It is not an opioid. It is not as addictive as what is being portrayed by people that have know people that had addictions. I've known family members that have died of addiction, and it wasn't cannabis. It's never cannabis. Never. And if they have did it with the others, that's one thing, but never alone is cannabis the reason for death. And let's not forget all the other alcohol-related businesses in this town. The Inn, the old pub, the two liquor stores, one of which is on Main Street, and the three restaurants that have bars as well. That's a lot of potential danger, and no one seems to have any issue with any of it. Which is funny, because compared to cannabis, I believe alcohol is way more dangerous of a drug. Way more dangerous. And concerns about on-site consumption, I ask all of you to consider the potential misconceptions you may have. Just remember, no alcohol would be permitted in these facilities. The nature of a cannabis high alone without alcohol does not typically mean a rowdy, potentially escalating crowd. At best, there may be a meeting of the minds, some laughter, and maybe some enjoyment of music and the arts. My last concern, and this is a touchy one for me, but I'm gonna present it because it does concern me. The alcohol industry is definitely challenged by the cannabis industry. Hence why you see alcohol companies entering the market trying to recapture their lost sales. Then, your family's business is directly connected to a bar owner, and that concerns me, that relationship. Your business is fiscally dependent upon them, and their success is dependent on this town. Do they see cannabis as a potential threat? Is that a question? Is an abstention potentially still maybe in order for tonight? Not that I'm implying anything from anyone. It's just you are directly in relationship with a bar, and I do think there is conflict for bars seeing the cannabis industry come into town. I thank you for your commitment, vote to this town. So please, don't stand in the way of any of this progress, please. And most importantly, please do not stand in the way of potential revenue for this town, especially when it needs it the most. Thank you all for your time and your consideration and for your commitment to doing what you do for this town. Thank you.
Ken, since we've got two public hearings, can I close one and start the other? Because it seems to bleed into
each other. I think the thing to do would be to inquire. I mean, if there's a lot of overlap in this, and I think the opinions that are expressed are going to be the same for either one. I mean, it's up to you guys.
I'm going to get ready to close the public hearing on the establishing an on-site cannabis consumption establishment. If there's anybody here or on Zoom that wishes to comment regarding that, they can do it now, or obviously they can do it when I open the next public hearing. But if not, I'm going to close the public hearing on introductory law number 2 of 2021, and I'm going to open the public hearing for the introduction for local law number 3, a local law adopted pursuant to cannabis law section 131, opting out of licensing and establishing retail cannabis dispensaries within the town of Tustin. So we can pick up where we left off, just going through a formality. Yes, Ida.
So I did not know that the meeting was starting at 6. I was told it was started at 6:15. I did not realize it was a separate situation. So all I want to say is what I said before applies to dispensary here, and I'm assuming that that's what we're going to be discussing. Now.
Correct. And
so I don't have to go through it again.
No.
I'm just telling
you. Everybody that's spoken to this point is speaking to both of them.
Thank you.
Any further public comment from the floor? Yes, Star.
I just wanted to say that.
You're going to have to come up. She was close enough to hear.
Okay. I'm coming.
Only for the Zoom audience.
Hello, Zoom.
And Jane.
Okay. Since this is split out into two things, and you're absolutely right, I think that many of the arguments about the licensing of on-site consumption establishments deal with the underlying fear of some people, rational or not, that any kind of attraction of being able to access cannabis is going to be a detrimental thing for people. I don't think it is. Certainly not if they have a license to sell, and then people go their merry way and go home and use it. That's even less, in my opinion, a problem than possibly potentially having the on-site consumption establishment. I don't necessarily think those are bad. I think that both of these laws are something that should be approved. It's definitely something that would be a benefit for people, and I agree with Paul Jen that it's not going to be something that can just run across the border and, oh, here you are in Sullivan County, let's go nuts, and then we can go back to Pennsylvania and be our own, you know, happy selves. I don't think that's going to happen.
Okay.
Donovan, this is important clarification.
You got to come up front for
this. This may already have been discussed. When they talk about on-site consumption, is that like cookies? Is that smoking? Is that what is on-site consumption?
That would probably be both of those.
Anything you wanted?
It would definitely include smoking.
I see. And this lady made a point that she thought that people from Pennsylvania wouldn't come over here and use this. Is there a legal prohibition? You have to be a Sullivan County resident to, or a New York State resident to consume pot in our local pot mill?
No.
So you can come from anywhere?
Yes.
So I'm not so certain about her last point. Thank you very much.
Well, I would just like to express that my family's been in this town. We've had business here for going on 70 years. And I don't like the idea of people trying to bring in a business. Not my husband.
To the board.
Not my husband. He has nothing to do with it. He is my husband. It's my family's business. And we've had one of the biggest revenues. Car sales, the tax on car sales. It's...
To the board.
I'm sorry, but...
Actually, to me.
Yes. The tax on car sales for over 70 years. That brings more income than anything else. But to have my family's name...
To the board.
Drug through the dirt, like we did something wrong, actually gets me very, very upset, being that I've been a member of this community, my family. My grandfather, Hankins, back by where the church is. And I just don't think that people should be dragging the Langs, the Landers. They've been here for years. They've been the ones bringing the revenue in this town. And I just think that people should think twice before they try to bring through the mud anything to do with my family or anybody in this town that's been in here for going on 100 years. All I'm saying.
Put on the tape.
Attorney.
Well, I said what he pretty much had to say at the last meeting. However, listening to the conversations tonight, it's basically medical marijuana, got a doctor's prescription, go for it. No problem. Doctor's prescription. Marijuana sales or marijuana bar doesn't fit in Harrisburg. Doesn't fit at all. It's a rural community. It's not New York City. If you like New York City and smoke pot, go back. Nobody's stopping you. No, it doesn't fit here. And that's all I've got to say out there.
I do have some questions from Zoom. Do I have anybody else on the floor before I go into Zoom?
One last comment. Follow up on what Kathleen was talking about. You can drag my name through the mud, I don't really care. But the bottom line is that to imply that our supervisor or anybody in this town has ulterior motives to push back against such a horrendous idea as putting a marijuana mill in our town, and implying that this gentleman or anybody in this town has ulterior motives to stop it because they want to make money in alcohol sales, that's a bunch of BS. I closed my bar down because it's such a tough environment, it's such a nasty environment in this state with all these crazy laws with the social distance stuff, like I'm the social distance police. The bottom line is that we have a right in this town to stand up, and Fenn does, and everyone on the board does, and believe what you believe, and they should not be throwing mud against you and say you have ulterior motives or conflict of interest. You have an attorney here. And I'm sure he will tell you the same thing. You stand by your motives. You stand by your decisions. You stand by this town. You stand by the culture of this town and push this thing back and keep it off our streets and keep our family and our children safe.
Bob? Then I'll get to Randy.
I'm sure I'm like quick. I'm kind of new to town. I own over 400 acres here. I have a big investment in this town. I don't want pot here.
I come from the city, a lot of pot there. I smoked a lot of pot as a youth. I don't want it here. It doesn't fit in the community. It's a community decision, not just a national thing. Thank you.
Randy?
Yeah, I'm understanding really this dynamic. It's nobody's looking to shut down bars, and I'm not maligning people who drink, and I'm sure a lot of you go home at night and have a drink to relax. And that's not medical marijuana. That's what marijuana can do for people. And it's legal now. It's not about if we want it or not. It's here in the state. And lots of people you guys know either deal it or do it in the town already. If you want to admit it to, in public or not. Like, I know that. And it's, who cares? Like, now it's going to be legal. It is legal. And if it's a relaxant and it helps people deal with this crazy world, then I think we should not say Narrowsburg exempt from that world. I mean, we're not. So it's not about people going back to the city. I'm here 32 years. I'm not going anywhere. And I just think, you know, if you have an open mind to all of it, I'm certainly not maligning anybody who had a bar ever in history or a liquor shop. I've known them all fine, it's all legal. I just want to kind of end that divide, which is bizarre to me. I'm sitting back there listening to this. So thank you.
Lisa?
Lisa DeAndrea? There's still muted. I'm getting there.
Okay, I just want to say that I think it's a little foolhardy to say that there's a potential 3% tax revenue that we could gain as a result of a potential marijuana dispensary or lounge or something like that without actually considering the consequences with respect to what would happen if we had one of those facilities in our neighborhood, in our community. We do not have a police force. There's a state police in town, however, everybody has to realize that there is no individual police force in town. The marijuana dispensaries, although they're legal, tend to be cash businesses. They're not legal. Marijuana is still federally illegal. You cannot possess marijuana under the federal laws. It is still illegal. Banks will not bank marijuana businesses. It is a crime on the federal level in order to possess marijuana. And I understand it's legal on the state level. However, I think that our town is not taking into consideration, or may not be taking into consideration, all of the ramifications of this. Yes, there may be a potential for 3% tax revenue that could benefit the town, but there's also a downside. We don't have a police force. There's the people that, if it's an on-site consumption, people are getting in their cars and driving. As somebody mentioned, we are a rural community. Everybody drives. It's not New York City. You don't have public transportation. It's not California. It's not LA. You don't have public transportation. So people are going to get in their car after having been at one of these lounges and wind up, God forbid, getting into an accident. Or worse yet, people will take it with them, smoke it up in their car, and drive off. So I just want to strenuously, I am firmly against any marijuana dispensary, any lounge, and I hope that the board will take all of that into consideration when considering this. That's it. Thank you.
Any more on the floor? Let me start with the ladies up front, and I'll work my way to the back. Iris, go ahead.
I am sorry to hear.
I'm sorry, I need you to come here, we can't see you.
I am sorry to hear that there is this feeling that Kathleen mentioned. This is not to besmirch anybody. I think that this is only a situation as a board that perhaps it might be a conflict of interest. It wouldn't matter, it is not anything to do with the family. The family is a fabulous family, and I don't think that that's how it was presented. It was just the way I heard it. If it was Al or if it was Jane who had some kind of connection with a similar type of business, that's how it was given, but not
to dispatch the name for the family.
It was not taken that way. I will clarify one thing. Kathleen is the owner of the business. I am not. And I think that gets lost in things, that when they look at me sitting here as a public official, I work for my wife, but it's not my business. And I think that kind of, you know, you've got a, the oldest business in the town of Tustin is run by a female.
Yes.
They kind of, you know, take offense to the fact that it's not my business. I'm an employee, but it's not my business. So, no offense is taken on this side, from you or from you. Donovan?
This is, again, a question. You may have already addressed it. Since it's not legal federally to possess pot, does that open the town of Tustin taxpayers to liabilities that we don't see on the table right now, that are not remotely in the debate? Are we exposing ourselves to financial liabilities that 6 months, a year down the road are going to come at us? I don't know the answer to that. Posing.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you. I was just saying what you said, and I just wanted to reiterate that. And Kathleen, like, totally not. I respect your business, and I have since the days of selling advertising through the River Reporter. So it really is not that. And I really said it in more of Danielle's business is my business, just like your business is that. And I understand yours has a family heritage to it. So I apologize for any disrespect that may have been felt. But I am just concerned about, you know, these financial relationships that we have that can put our, and I am not implying you doing anything either. It's just, you know, your family's business is potentially affected by what happens to the new owner of that building. Mm-hmm. And that was all I was trying to say. To address this gentleman's question about the town liability, 70% of the states have this. I don't know if the federal government's going to pick the town of Tustin to start this federal issue with. There are things happening in the Senate right now. Everything is moving in that direction. It is strange that we have this situation, but there is a reason why the states can independently set their own constitution, right? So we are dealing with American society, and it is where it is right now, folks. It just is where it is. And the pot is here, and everyone that's smoking it is smoking it. And it's not going to feel much different afterwards, except we'll feel different. Why? Because we can legally consume what we've been consuming for decades. And I don't have to be a criminal anymore. I don't have to be a criminal anymore. Buying on the streets, that culture, that's created part of this problem. And I am not talking about legalizing opiates, heroin, crack, cocaine, all the addictions that you know and have watched your family suffer from. That is not this. This is something like alcohol that needs to be addressed and legally provided a platform to exist. That's how you control situations. You don't keep pushing them into the streets. And that's what's happening, is you're pushing them into the streets. And you're making regular citizens be criminals to live, to have a pleasant life, to have a drink when you come home at night. I mean, think about that. If you had to be doing something illegal to have a beer at night, I mean, it's insane. Thank you all, and I'm sorry. I hate conflict, I really do. And I want us to be a community, and I love all my neighbors that I'm disagreeing with right now. Love you all. Thank you. I can't help it.
I just want to clarify one thing. The financial relationship with Frederick is not the bar. He's going to get into electric vehicles.
This,
I read from
this
him.
Has nothing to do with the bar.
I know. But what I'm saying is, he wants me there because one day I'm going to help him sell these electric vehicles for the clerk.
There is no other public comment. I'm going to close the public hearing.
Amen.
Before I get in trouble. Is there any other public comment?
Yeah, actually.
Okay.
I can't resist. To address whichever person made the comment about there won't be much traffic from Pennsylvania, don't believe it for a minute, because when New York had an 18 drinking age and Pennsylvania had a 21, they're right. The roads were being burned up from east to west like crazy. I wouldn't have my husband without it, because that's where we all came. If we have an establishment that sells pot in town, Pennsylvania will find its way here. And don't be misled by the notion that they will only come from Beach Lake or maybe Honesdale, because when the drinking age was 18, they came from as far away as Scranton every single weekend. So I think, you know, will the salesperson be making more money? Yeah, but I think you'll be opening up to a lot more legal ramifications, because, you know, people like to sue these days, and they will go after any suspect vendor in the process.
Rick, do you want to
go? Yeah, just on the retail aspect of it, you know, we're not saying that you can smoke all you want, but go buy it in Bethel. I feel it's not a Narrowsburg situation for our kids and our lifestyle. And we have a lot of vested interest. I've been here 65 years. And I wish there'd be more people coming from the city that'd be more interested in joining the ambulance, the fire department that we really need. And instead, we worry about building pot and getting accessibility. We've just got the wrong issues here.
Bernie. Well, that pretty much said what I said last month, and I have to agree with that. There was a wreck every week. And everybody knows somebody that wiped out a car somewhere between here and Honesdale, points west.
I just want to say, the law is clear when it comes to marijuana. The law is clear when it comes to the legalization of marijuana, that me, as an individual, has the right to grow 6 marijuana plants at home and use freely as I want. I can tell you that there are people in this town who are growing 6 marijuana plants. They are harvesting them, and they have a clientele. So your dispensary isn't going to change much around here, because you're still going to have that dealer who wants to put the money in his pocket and not the town's pocket, not in the government's pocket, in their pocket. Tax-free money in their pocket. So if you put in a dispensary, you don't change anything. That's what you don't understand. You're not changing anything. I'm legally allowed to grow 6 plants. So if I grow 6 plants and I hook up with somebody who grows 6 plants and he hooks up with somebody, we build a clientele base. So we don't need a dispensary. I don't need the town to get my money and then have to pay a tax on that. No, it's free money for me. So you're always going to have a dealer.
Just one more question. Is it possible to get an answer to the question about possible future liabilities, given before the town takes a vote on this issue?
Right now, our council feels that there is not.
Yeah, I don't think there's a high risk of it, honestly.
What are you basing that thought
on? Well, based on experience of all these years with alcohol, have you ever seen a municipality sued over the fact that every time there's an application for a 30-day waiver?
Well, if you go back to prohibition, yes. But this is a new thing. This is new. We have a situation where the state says one thing and the federal government says another.
I'm not going to argue with you. I'm just like, you asked the opinion. You got my opinion.
I'm asking you what you're basing it on.
And I told you.
Which is
experience. You haven't seen a lot of people. You haven't seen a lot of alcohol establishments.
And I'm saying in response that there's no experience in this situation, so...
That may be true, but it's...
Your opinion isn't worth very much, is it?
Okay, that's your opinion.
Yes, it is.
There you go. You're entitled to that.
Thank you. Brandy?
Sorry, just one last point. Yes, people are allowed to grow 3 immature plants and 3 mature plants. Absolutely not for sale. That is illegal. You're not supposed to deal. It's private use, adult use only over 21. Let's clarify that.
I wasn't going to say anything because I spoke at the last one. But the dispensary experience in Massachusetts that I've seen.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Massachusetts is not that far away. The experience there is that in some ways people are right in saying it's not a Narrowsburg thing, because Narrowsburg is a small town. It has 1,500 whatever, and it is 25 miles from a major highway. No one in their right mind is going to put a dispensary in Narrowsburg. It's just not going to happen. It's like saying, let's vote against a Whole Food. We were getting all upset about something that's really not going to happen. I think it says the wrong message if we opt out, because we're saying a lot of what was said by others about it needs to be taken out of the criminal realm. And I think that the state did the right thing. But we're not arguing about this. If you have a beef with the state's legalization of marijuana, go to Albany. That's not what we're arguing. It's not what we're talking about here. And another thing, comparing it to the drinking situation in the 80s or whatever is absurd, because encouraging 18, 19, and 20-year-olds to come and elite and drink and drive is very different from the dispensary situations that I've seen in Massachusetts. It's an adult. People who go to a dispensary, we literally want to obey the law. It's a nerdy crowd. It is not a druggy crowd. These are people who go out of their way to do the right thing, to obey the law. So demonizing it, I can understand. Everyone's had bad experiences in their families. They know of addiction, and I respect that. And I'm not immune to that. But let's talk about what the real decision is, not relitigating something that Albany decided a year ago.
Any other public comment? If there is not, I am going to close the public comment on local law number 3. This time, I'll call the meeting to order for the regular meeting of the Town of Tustin.